Love in a Fog. From time to time, other figures emerged with an uncanny suddenness from the darkness, and passed with as unnatural swiftness into it again, like the unreal phantoms of a lantern slide. We are no other than a moving row of magic shadow shapes that come and go, quoted Brewster with the pleasure that accompanies an aptly remembered phrase, a pleasure that with him never palled, as it so often does, for want of an appreciative listener other than oneself. And then, having caught up that string of oriental pearls in the middle, he fell to long for the seceding beads until the beautiful fatalism, more impressive in that loneliness than ever before, seemed to lessen his habitual self-reliance. Until now, the thought of being lost never entered his head, although he had been walking in that confusing and absolute gloom for over a quarter of an hour. He stood quite still and tried to think out the compass, grasping in rueful and credulous amusement as wave after wave of bewildered uncertainty swept over him. It was just at this moment, as he so stood, trying to realize that he, Ralph Brewster, hunter and ardent woodsman, was more hopelessly turned about in the most familiar part of London than he had ever been in the depth of the forest primeval, that a distinct, quick call smote him from somewhere beyond in the muffling fog. It came again. "Help me! Come to me, someone!" A woman's voice, unmistakably, unmistakably, too, the voice of a refined woman, and holding in it to Brewster's ear, an ear curiously sensitive where voices were concerned, a strange mingling of fright and command. "Yes," he called in reply, trying to brush away the choking cloud with impatient hands. "Hold on, I'm coming. Speak again so that I can place you." In answer, the haunting voice sounded once more, this time seemingly ahead and a little to the right. "Here I am. Come at once, please." The imperative note was even more distinguishable, and Brewster steered toward the sound with outstretched, groping arms. In a minute he called again, "Where are you now?" And this time the response came more faintly from the left. "Here, can you not find me?" Its command more insistent than ever. "For heaven's sake," Brewster shouted, "keep still if you don't want me to lose you altogether. Don't move a single step, and call to me steadily." His voice now held an imperative ring, and the woman evidently recognized its masterfulness, for she did as he commanded, and again Ralph plunged forward toward the intangible sweetness of the calling voice. A London fog is almost as deceptive to ears as to eyes, and thus it happened that before the object of his search seemed to the man's hearing close at hand, his groping hands touched something which loomed up with such suddenness out of the obscurity that a rather sharp collision was inevitable. Brewster drew back apologetically, and the girl, for it was only a girl, uttered an exclamation of indignant surprise, followed by a little ripple of inconsistent, involuntary laughter, checked as soon as born. "Oh," she said, "I'm very glad you have found me at last. What a long time you were about it. I have been lost for quite an hour in this frightful fog, and I must get home at once." "I should have found you sooner," Brewster retorted, somewhat resentfully, for her tone suggested a condescension unbearable under the circumstances. "But you must have moved, did you not, after I first called?" "Of course I did," the girl replied with spirit. "I tried to come to meet you." "Oh, that is fatal in a fog," Brewster exclaimed. "Two people drift apart at once if they play at cross purposes like that, for between calls they may be moving in exactly opposite directions. The only way is to remain stationary as a foghorn," the girl suggested brightly, with a keen, quick glance at her companion. In spite of the dusky dimness in which he was partially shrouded, though close at her side, both his voice and bearing convinced her that the man was a gentleman in whom she might trust, and her manner changed a trifle, although the condescension was still slightly noticeable. "Exactly," Brewster agreed gravely. Then, courteously, "I rather fear I am lost myself, but I may be able to be of some assistance to you. It is a frightful night for a woman to be out alone, and dangerous as well. Where do you wish to go?" The implied disapproval of this remark seemed to sting the girl to an explanation. In spite of herself, she began with an increased haughtiness. "To the Metropoli. Surely it cannot be very far. I came out early this afternoon to the National Gallery, and while there sent my companion off on an errand. She was to return in an hour at 4 o'clock, but after I grew tired of looking at the pictures and found the time was up, of course, impatiently, I could wait no longer, and so I started home. But the fog, surely by that time, it must have been very thick. You should never have attempted." "Yes," she admitted unwillingly, "it was thick, and it grew worse so rapidly. But what would you do?" With a pretty oddly foreign gesture. "I could wait no longer. I knew the way, and who could have dreamed it would so soon become like this?" A shade of mischievous regret crept into her voice as she added, as if to herself, "How they will scold poor Natalie. She too is lost, I fear. That is what kept her. I thought it could be nothing but sudden death, she grumbled so at leaving me. But, turning abruptly, you will take me home, sir, as quickly as possible, will you not?" "You may be sure of that," returned Ralph, again slightly nettled. Where in the world lay the charm of staying out longer than was necessary in a cold, dank fog with this pert, self-willed schoolgirl, he should like to know. He asked himself the question angrily and was surprised to find another self-recognizing that, absurd as it might seem, there was a distinct charm. "But why do we not move on, then?" With a sudden surrender to the humor of the situation, Brewster broke into a laugh. "Move on?" he said. "Yes, we might, if you only knew in which direction to move." The girl watched him a minute, and then joined in. The laugh cleared the mental atmosphere, if not the material one. Then Brewster asked, "How long have you been calling when I came?" "Only a minute. I could not bear to speak sooner. I did not know who might answer, and I thought I must find my way in time. It is such a short distance, you know. I'm sure I started right at first, but then, after a time, I came to such a dreadful place, all noisy men and wagons, and it was then that I became so turned around and hopelessly tangled, I suppose, for pretty soon I found myself here, apparently in a place where there was nobody. I stood it as long as I could, and then I could not bear it any longer. It was unspeakable, the loneliness. I called, and then you answered." Yes, her voice was marvelously sympathetic. In its flexible changes, Brewster could trace every gradation of her experience, the arrogant self-confidence of her departure, the shrinking disgust at the rough, clamoring crowd, the desperate, overmastering sensation of loneliness, and finally the passionate relief at his answer to her appeal. The hint of this last feeling thrilled him swiftly, and he felt all at once an immeasurable desire and capacity to move mountains, in order that this delicate, high-bred girl beside him might walk unobstructed henceforth. Unfortunately, no mountains were at hand, only the fog, grim, relentless, omnipresent, like a melodramatic ghost, the clutch of whose clammy fingers no power other than the elements could shake off. But her words gave him a clue. "I say," he exclaimed gladly, "see here, you must have been wandering about in a circle around the square. That would account for there being so few people. If that's the case, we'll soon find our bearings. Yes, I started out from the Oxford and Cambridge Club 15 minutes or so ago, and so far as I can make out, I've been heading east ever since. Walking rather slowly, that ought to bring me by now just about to Trafalgar Square." "Nonsense," his companion declared. "I could hardly be so stupid as to walk around in a circle. It is unreasonable." "Oh, but I assure you it's not unreasonable in the least," Brewster protested. "It's what every inexperienced person does when lost. It's the most natural thing in the world. We'll move forward slowly, and if I'm right, as I begin to think I must be, we'll soon strike something that will prove it." Move forward, accordingly, they did, cautiously, for the fog was like a dense wall, behind which no fate seemed too subtle or fearsome to lurk. And sure enough, before long they did meet a lion in the path, a Landseer lion, by which token Brewster knew at once that Nelson's column was at hand, a vantage point from which to base further calculations. "Here we are," he exclaimed joyfully. "This is better luck than I dared hope for. If we had struck any of these other old duffers, whose pedestals are alike as peas, it would have been as complicated as the highest sort of mathematics. As it is, the problem simple as ABC. "I do not really see that we are so much better off than before," the girl answered, with a sort of triumphant willfulness. "As I remember it, there are four lines, are there not? And consequently four sides to Nelson's column. How do you know which side this is, then? It seems to me that there are just three chances to one against our starting out in the right direction from here." "Then it's simply a case of, if at first you don't succeed, try, try, try again," Ralph retorted, with rising good humor. "This is my plan. The column is in the center of the square, east and west, but it is very near to the curb on the south side, while the southeast line, if my architectural head doesn't play me false, points directly toward Northumberland Avenue, which, as you know, is the street we're after. So, you see, all we have to do is start straight ahead from the side we're on and walk about 20 paces. Then, if we don't come to the curb, do as the King of France did, march back again, and begin all over from another side, until we do strike it. Do you see?" Yes, she saw, with a quick grasp of his points that delighted Brewster, as did still more the girlish gusto and abandon which she entered into the whole thing. He grasped one end of her slim little umbrella, telling her to hold to the crook behind him, while he made wild lunges ahead with his cane, because, as he said, "you never can tell what lusus naturae you may meet with at any minute in a London fog." They both shuddered at the thought of the way she might have pitched headlong down the steps that connect the curious stone terraces of Trafalgar Square. In the heat of this discussion, during the second voyage of exploration from the column, they lost count of their steps, and before they knew it, were confronted with a pedestal, which Brewster declared must be that of General Gordon, who had embraced the opportunity of the fog to move up and hobnob with Nelson, since it had surely never been so close before. They faced about, and he made for the column again, in secret, perturbation lest they had been turned about and bumped into one of the other statues, in which case their friendly vantage point would not be forthcoming. But he was relieved to find he was right, and there had been no more serious mistake than in the extra number of steps they had taken. Out again for the third time. Ralph felt as if they were two children, playing at nothing more responsible or arduous than a game of blind man's bluff. And when, at the fourth venture, they finally found the long-lost curb, with a unanimous exclamation in which triumph and regret were ridiculously blended, the man had a keen sensation that they might claim to be old, old friends by this time, as become those who have grown up together through a long, happy youth. Back for the last time to the column steps, to the left of which, facing the curb, crouches the southeast lion, gazing with stony eyes down Northumberland Avenue. "Good for Nelson," ejaculated Brewster. "To have beaten Napoleon's fleet was nowhere beside overcoming a London fog." And the girl laughed merrily. "He has always been one of my heroes. I shall appreciate him more than ever after this." When they started slowly on again, she asked, gently, as if touched by his patient persistence and clever planning, "I hope I'm not taking you greatly out of your way. It would be such a pity." And Brewster answered with a joyous ring in his voice, "Not in the least. Why, we're close neighbors. Isn't it odd? I'm staying at the Victoria, right next to you. You see, it was the very luckiest thing in the world, my running across you. I should never have gotten my own bearings without your hints." "How good you are to put it so. I think the indebtedness is all on my side. I was foolish," she admitted, with a degree of mental surprise at the concession which would have amazed Ralph Brewster, simply because he could not have comprehended it. To him, owning to a fault was the most natural and immediate outcome of its recognition. "But who could have dreamed of this?" she went on. "Oh, what a country, this England of yours. It would kill me. I could not breathe in it. Faugh!" But it is not my England, Brewster answered, laughing at the vivid disdain of her voice. I'm an American, you know, and that accounts for my stupidity in dealing with this sort of thing. If I'd been a Britisher, I should have had you home long ago, I dare say. He ended with a mental reservation. Thank heaven I'm not, then, which, if revealed, might in turn have been a surprise to his companion. She looked up interestedly. America, she said. I might have known it. But why were you so surprised then? I thought it was a custom over there for women to do exactly as they pleased, to go out and about alone and unprotected at any hour. Oh, how I have longed for the freedom of it all at times. She ended with a note of weariness that caught Brewster's quick ear. You are then, I am a German, she answered with a sort of finality that somehow checked the further questioning which rose to Ralph's lips. As they reached the street on which the metropolis stands, a huge dray lumbered up suddenly out of the blackness behind, and with a quick backward motion of his arm, trained years before to pull stroke on his varsity eight, Ralph caught the girl from her feet and lifted her around in front of him, out of the way of the uncouth and mammoth thing. When they moved on, he reached out and drew her arm up through his, holding it firmly to his side, while around them, all around them, the blessed, the kindly fog shut down again, separating them from the rest of the world, leaving him in a new world of his own, with this one woman, in whose presence he was conscious of a restfulness that was akin to nothing, perhaps so much as the glad surprise of quiet, deep, harbored waters after a stormy uncertainty. And now for a while they did not speak at all, but Brewster knew by a sort of sixth sense that her silence held no estrangement. They moved on as if in a dream. Was it indeed anything else? The isolation, the unreality of past or future, of anything but the intense, all-sufficing present, the complete disconnection with any fellowship beyond the limitless one of the other dream figure at his side, that figure so vital and real where it touched him closely, but fading itself at the farther points into unsubstantiality. Where but in a dream could one find such conditions? Just before they reached the hotel, the girl turned, pointing to a light which flashed by them only to be swallowed up the next instant into nothingness again. What are those, she said, those lights? I have noticed them at intervals ever since we started. A sudden temptation rose in Brewster's heart, grappled with his speech, and was worsted. He had yielded tacitly to one already, but he would at least be honest with her now. There was a dread, however, in his eyes as he looked down at her. Those are the Link Boys, he said seriously. The Link Boys, she repeated, questioningly. Yes, the Link Boys, he continued, unsparingly. The men who carry about lighted torches and make it their business to find people who are lost in the London fogs and show them to their destination. Unconsciously, he was repeating the phraseology of a London guidebook, but his eyes held hers as he spoke. Then when we were lost, she faltered, you might all the time. Yes, I might have hailed one, and he would have led us home in half the time, Ralph blurted out. It was caddish, it was dishonorable in me, but I, forgive me, I... He stopped, for he felt, rather than saw, that his companion was smiling. It was better so, she said, with a sweet, light graciousness. It was most thoughtful. I should so much have preferred you to bring me home quietly like this, than to have come in, how do you say it, a torchlight procession? In another instant they had reached the entrance, and with his swift return to everydayness, Brewster found his exalted sensations replaced by the most lusty and prosaic hatred, malice, and all uncharitableness. The girl drew her arm from his with a quick determination and lifted her face. As she did so, and he saw it clearly for the first time, in the subdued glare, the man was struck by its expression, sort of hopeless weariness, inconsistent with its use in extreme fairness. No, do not come any further, she said gently, when he made as if to accompany her up the steps. Please, I do not wish it. It only remains for me to thank you. Indeed, I do thank you, she continued hesitatingly, but with a deeper note, which lent a new gravity and dignity to her beautiful voice. "You have spared me great trouble, and you saved my life, I think, that time when the wagon. I'm glad to owe my life to you. I'm glad to have known you. I wish I, too, had been born in America. Will you not tell me your name, that I may remember my good friend?" Brewster fumbled eagerly in his pocket and handed her his card. "It was nothing. It was everything. I mean, I am so glad," he murmured confusedly, for the happiness her words gave him impeded speech. "So glad to have been of the least service." They were standing at the foot of the hotel steps, a little to the side where she had stopped him. People were jostling by them, in and out of the warm, brilliantly lighted hallway beyond, against the brightness of which her slender figure was silhouetted tenderly, her hair making a soft halo about her shadowed face. Behind them lay the fog, in the sphinx-like depths of which the man fancied that he had found an answer to the riddle of his life. He held out both hands. "Your name," he said disconnectedly. "This is only Auf Wiedersehen. I must see you again. The girl seemed surprised at the impetuous gesture, but the next instant she laid her hand confidingly in his eager ones. Then she straightened and drew them gently away. Her names came softly. "My name is Alexandrine Henneberg." "Goodbye, my friend. I thank you, always," she said, and then was gone up the steps. For a minute or two he stood where she had left him, gazing stupidly after her. Then he pulled himself together with a short, happy laugh, and, turning, groped his way back through the fog to his own hotel. Arrived there in the friendly seclusion of his own room, he paced up and down in a sort of exaltation. His passage had been engaged for the following Saturday, but he had thought of that as he came in and had wired from the hotel office, giving up his stateroom. How exalted now to think how completely he was his own master, appreciating the good fortune of his singular aloneness as never before. What was to hinder if he chose to follow his fog maiden, his will-o'-wisp, through all the world? Plans? Her plans should be his. As for him, he would make no plans. And forthwith he set to work at the most tempting architecture in the world, castle building. How it all haunted him, every turn of her head, every intonation of her voice. Why, his impression of the girl was as vivid as if he had known her all his life. As indeed he had, he told himself, convincingly, for life had only begun with him from the moment he had heard that calling name. Alexandrine. How perfectly it suited her, the beginning of it, stately and imperious, with a tender, playful, diminutive ending. The whole name full of dignity and strength, and yet so womanly. Henneberg. Ah, that was not so good. Too German, perhaps. An American name would be better. He laughed at himself again, for his own eager boyishness, glad of his youth, glad of his wealth and good name, that he might use them all as helps in winning her. He must be patient, oh yes, and circumspect, and not let her dream at first, or frighten her by the suddenness of it all. He would invent excuses. He would employ Machiavellian adroitness in explaining his presence, his behavior. Yes, he would be patient. Tomorrow he would wait to present himself till afternoon. He would leave her the whole morning free. A morning, a month rather, but he would leave it to her, free, in the afternoon at 4, or possibly 3. Possibly at 2, he would call, and so on, and so on. Till far into the morning, which he had so generously resolved to abnegate. Accordingly, the next day he killed time in numerous ways. He read the newspaper, and then caught himself wondering what the deuce there was in it anyway. Then he took a piece of paper and grew intensely absorbed over a rough map of their journeyings in the fog the night before, living every step of the way over again. "But, oh, there is another crime I haven't mentioned yet," he quoted under his breath when he came to Nelson's column. "I stole the third trip, my lady. I wonder if it occurred to you that General Gordon could have directed us without the extra excursion." He labeled the plan, map of the world, and then tucked it tenderly away in his wallet, smiling to himself as he speculated how long it would be before he would dare to tell her about it, to show it to her. After this, he dressed with more care and temper than he had ever before expended, fuming at his man and then sending him out of the room, the proud and forgiving possessor of an all but brand new suit of clothes and a top hat. Subsequently, he made his way over to Hyde Park, where he strode up and down the row in the mellow October sunshine, whose hazy quality was the sole legacy of yesterday's fog. As he walked there in the soft, kindly air, watching the people with an amiable benevolence and universal overflowing goodwill towards men, which he himself would have described as doting, there was a sudden stir, and then an open carriage came bowling rapidly along, a very fine carriage, in fact, a most noticeable carriage, with a curiously familiar coat of arms on paneling and trappings. As it came toward him, Brewster recognized the Princess of Wales, who sat on the back seat, beside a very stately old individual, whose breast so glittered with insignia that one naturally inferred he must be a very important individual indeed. Then, as they flashed quickly past, the face of a girl on the front seat, with her back to the horses, arrested his carelessly interested eye, and burned itself with its inner consciousness. A girl with a slender, beautifully clad figure, with a cloud of light, wind-blown hair, and a small flower-like face on which was stamped the expression of bored weariness which Ralph had noticed once in the eyes of his fog maiden of the night before. Just at that instant she caught sight of the man leaning forward, breathlessly from the fringe of pedestrians. The bored look vanished, and a sudden brilliant flush swept across her face for a second, and left it tense and paler than before, as she bent forward over the side of the carriage with an indescribably pathetic gesture of recognition. Brewster had just sense enough left to remain uncovered until they had disappeared, but his own face was white as he turned to a gentlemanly-looking Englishman, who stood beside him and asked unsteadily, "Can you tell me the name of that lady on the front seat of the carriage, which has just passed?" The Englishman looked with a slow curiosity into the eager, questioning eyes, which he afterwards decided belonged to one of those aristocracy worshippers from the other side. Then, good-naturedly and with a keen relish himself at the titled morsel under his tongue, "Isn't she beautiful?" he said. "Didn't you recognize her? Why, that was Her Serene Highness, Alexandrine, Princess of Saxe-Weissenach and Countess of Henneborg." End of Love in a Fog